So I feel a little bit like the backup quarterback right now since Neil's out. I'm kind of like filling in for him because he's a lot better than me, so I'm like the backup or whatever. But you guys are here, so you're stuck with me. So I've been thinking a lot about, it's just been on my heart lately, about stepping out of my comfort zone and really talking about about really just stepping out of your comfort zone and just fulfilling what God has in store for me, and that's just what's been on my mind lately. So it may be that I'm talking to myself tonight, but you guys are here, so again, you're stuck with what I'm thinking about. So I've been thinking a lot about Esther. Esther is one of the only two women in the Bible that has a complete book dedicated to her life and what God did through her, and then what she was able to do in her situation that God put her in. And it's kind of interesting, though, that she has this whole book dedicated to her, but it starts out, the first three verses of Esther are talking about a party that the king Xerxes had. It was a 180-day party that he was having. It was just interesting that that's how they start the book of Esther. It's not even talking about Esther. It's talking about this big party. But it kind of sets the ground for Esther's life and what she did and how God was able to use her. But it talks about Xerxes having this big old party that he's having. And towards the end of it, he's throwing this huge banquet for all his nobles and all the special people in his kingdom. And the queen at the time, Queen Vashti, she's having a party for her own people, for the women in the courts and all that. So Xerxes is hanging out with his buddies or whatever, and he calls for Queen Vashti to come because he wants to show off her beauty, is what the Bible says. He wants to show her off, and she refuses to come, and that just infuriates him. His wife won't come to his party when he commands her to come. So he talks to his buddies, and he's like, "What do I do about this?" And they're like, "Oh, throw her out. She can't be disobeying you like this. You're the king. You are King Xerxes of Persia. You can't be disrespected like this." So he gets rid of her. And then this is where Esther comes into the story, because now Xerxes needs a queen. So it talks about Xerxes sends people out into the land to find all the eligible young virgins that are beautiful and everything. So he calls for all these virgins to come, and they go through these beauty treatments and everything. And along comes Esther. Esther is an orphan that is adopted by her uncle Mordecai. And it talks about how Esther was brought into the court with all the other virgins, and how she stood out, how her beauty stood out. But most of all, it talks about how she pleased the people that she was around. It talks more about how she was able, through her character, she was able to please the people and just really connect to the people more than how beautiful she was. People liked her more because of the person she was and not her stunning beauty. So eventually she goes before King Xerxes, and King Xerxes appoints her to be his queen. So now she went from an orphan, and now she's the queen of all of Persia. And that's kind of a big deal. So she becomes queen, and so she's really good at pleasing people. She pleases the king of Persia more than anybody else in the land does. So she's really good at that. But her uncle Mordecai, who's adopted her, is not quite as good as she is about pleasing people. Because the king's right-hand man is a man named Haman. And he's kind of the number two guy in the kingdom behind King Xerxes. And King Xerxes appoints him high above everybody else and gives him an honor that whenever he goes out anywhere, people were supposed to bow down to him. Well, the one person that doesn't is Queen Esther's cousin, uncle Mordecai. He refuses to bow to him, and this infuriates him. He's number two behind King Xerxes, and this infuriates him that he refuses to bow. It says that Mordecai refused to bow to him and would only bow to God, and that infuriated Haman. So here's Queen Esther that's pleasing all the people and just making herself really high up and pleasing people. But here's her uncle that's just doing whatever he wants to do to please God, even though it makes Haman infuriate. So Haman doesn't like this, so he goes to King Xerxes, since he's the number two guy, and says, hey, there's these people, because he found out that Mordecai was a Jew. So he goes to King Xerxes and says, hey, these are these people that they do what they want, and they don't listen to you, they don't listen to me, we need to wipe them out. So King Xerxes is like, yeah, go ahead, do whatever you want, kill them all, I don't care. So Haman devises this plan that on a certain day, all the Jews were to be killed. To anybody that wanted to can come in and just kill any Jew for any reason, for their stuff, for their houses, anything they wanted, just because they were a Jew. So Mordecai hears about this and is deeply disturbed about it and comes to Queen Esther and says, all right, you're a Jew, and nobody knows that because Mordecai had commanded her not to tell anybody that she was a Jew. So Queen Esther's in this position where her people on a certain day are going to be killed. And she's a Jew. So she is in this position to where she has the power to maybe help her people because she's queen to Xerxes. So Mordecai comes to her and tells her, and verse 13 through 14, and he says, do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But for you and your father's family will perish. And who knows that you come to this royal position in such a time as this. So Mordecai comes to her and says, this is your job. You go before the king and tell him to stop this. Tell him to save your people. You are in this position for a reason. God put you in this place to make a difference in the lives of all the Israelites. You are here for a reason. God put you in this place to do something special. But Esther tells them in the 16th chapter that, or in the 15th chapter, that anybody that goes before the king was to be killed. No one could go before the king unannounced. So Queen Esther couldn't just go up to Xerxes and say, hey, can you do this for me? The king had to command her, or had to request her presence. So Esther comes before, or talks to Mordecai and says, hey, I can't just go up and ask this guy for anything I want. He's the king. I can't do anything I just want. But Mordecai tells her that you're in this position for a reason, that if you don't go before the king, then someone else will come and deliver the Israelites. But you're in this position for a reason, that God put you here to help. So what does Queen Esther do? She's put in this awkward position to where she could die if she goes before the king, if he doesn't want her there. She could die. But her family could die too. But she's like, well, do I let someone else step up? Do I let someone else save the Israelites? Because if I mess up, then I'm dead. So, but she comes back with this cool verse in chapter 16. And she tells Mordecai, go gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and the fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days or nights. I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. So she's faced with the biggest decision of her life. And she chooses two different things. First, she chooses to be used. She chooses to put herself out and take whatever comes to her. If she dies, she dies, is what she says. She puts herself out and says, God, just use me. But she doesn't just do that. She prays. She has everybody fast for her and pray for 3 days and three nights. And that's what's very special about here at City on a Hill. You don't bear your problems alone. We are here for you. Will just took prayer. For anything that you have, as a family, we are here for each other, and we bear each other's burdens. And that's what Queen Esther does. She doesn't just say, okay, I'll go to the king and whatever happens, happens. She prays earnestly, and then she has others join in and bear the burden of what happens. And that's it's so special about Queen Esther. She allows herself to be used. She allows others to help her in this situation that she was put in, to be used by others. So what happens to Queen Esther is the question. Well, if you don't know, she goes before the king, and the king is pleased by her presence, and he accepts her, and she eventually saves her people. She saves all the people that were going to die. She saves them, and they use that day that they were all supposed to be killed, and now it was a holiday that they used, because the king made a law that they could defend themselves. And so what Haman had used for evil, God through Esther made for good. Esther was able to take something terrible and use it to be a holiday for the Jews. And she let herself be used by God to help others. So that was my thought. If anybody has anything, we have an open mic. If anybody has a thought or anything they want to say, come up and say something.
I just have something really quick to say. Today, or this week, I was kind of struggling this weekend, for sure. I'm in my last month of grad school, and everything is really stressful, and I'm struggling with this.
I'll help.
Here.
Oh, okay.
That's better.
That's fine.
I've just been stressed out and feeling just overwhelmed and kind of just alone in it. I mean, I've got support and everything, but it's just a lot of things that I have to do and no one else can help me with. And the songs that we were singing today just really, they spoke to me. The song Good Good Father is really a good song that I listen to often. And it made me think back when I was a teenager. I had a lot of petty problems. And I went to Papa Joel once. He's my father in the situation, and I was just, it was dumb problems, but he came and he just had a way of just making me feel better, and it didn't really change the circumstance or anything, but he just made me feel better. He came in and he's like, I know what'll fix this, and he offered me a Spam sandwich, and it helped. Didn't fix it completely, but it definitely helped me feel better. And God, no matter my petty adult problems that aren't even that big of a deal, but they are to me, he just makes me feel better. And I didn't want to come today, and I hate to say that. I just wanted to stay home, and I was struggling, and I came today, and I feel so much better, and I just kind of got my Spam sandwich from God or something. But I'm just thankful for City on a Hill and a place to come and just worship. So that's all.
Well, I appreciate it tonight, too, and there was different lines in those songs that were a blessing, and I'm sure as many different people as are sitting here tonight, just like Chelsea, she had her specific situation and things that these gave encouragement to her for, but it's something beautiful about the work of the Lord and the Spirit of the Lord and His Word, the same song or expression or feelings, they have a power and an ability to touch your individual problem. It'll be the same phrase, but what you're dealing with and what somebody else is dealing with, that is, you would think we're at opposite ends of the spectrum, that beautiful thought that the Lord will give and anoint and bless somebody to write, will deal with those problems for you, or will give you direction, or will give you a way to go. And it's something I've been thinking about this week. I was looking at that book that they're going through on Wednesday evenings, and they didn't do it this week, but the title of the, I think the next chapter is something about follow the leader. And when I just saw the title, I was thinking, you know, probably old school thinking, you know, well, who is it that I'm supposed to be following, some leader? But then you get reading in it and you find out that obviously it's talking about one most wonderful leader is our Lord Jesus Christ. And it just, I didn't get through all of it yet, but it was just telling us that it's very important that if he's the leader, we really need to know something about him. And so I was thinking of through, you know, it's, you know, when I come here, I kind of help the age demographics here. I kind of average it out up a little bit. But, you know, been reading the scriptures many years, heard many good messages and testimonies. And I'm still at times intrigued by how I feel like I don't really know enough about him yet. And I don't know enough about all the blessings and the things that he can do for us. And I just began to think about it. I think some of the phrases in this book were saying we need to really learn about him. And I thought of just my experience over the years. You can read the Gospels or read things, and in my background, this maybe is not true for everyone here, but it was a time, even I think general in religion or in Protestant circles or whatever, that there was a heavy emphasis on doctrine. And there was periods through the 40s and 50s and 60s where, and that's, you know, I couldn't believe it. Here a few weeks ago, I looked up how many denominations there are. I figured there might be a few hundred, a thousand. There's 30,000 recognized Protestant denominations. That's crazy. I mean, that's unbelievable. And you know, most of those denominations, the reason they started was over, a lot of them was over interpreting a different, one word in a, and maybe it was a different word even in another translation, but they just couldn't come together on that. So, bless God, we're going to go start our own place. And then we'll start our own denomination. We'll have our own creeds. And so here it goes. And I thought in all that examination of all these doctrinal issues, I really think a lot of times I was missing the true spirit of Christ. I was missing what was so precious about our Lord. And so I've started in reading through the Gospels as I read each story. And I would encourage some of the younger ones, as you, it may be at times difficult to read, but when you read in the Gospels and you read a story about something Jesus did, or you read one of his parables especially, but also how he treated different situations that he came up across. Stop and reflect on what is it about the beauty of Jesus that I see in that story. I used to read it to try to have a scripture to whip out and beat somebody over the head with, or convince them of what I thought was right, or to condemn them, or, you know, ban them to the, you know, kick them out of the glee club or whatever. And I've run across some people in my travels, even the last year or so out on the West Coast, that their big claim to fame was marking and shunning. And they really, boy, they took those three or four scriptures in the, where Paul said you shouldn't eat with a certain type of person or this or that. And that was one of their big features, is how quickly they could mark and shun somebody. And they didn't care if they did it in families or whatever. But the beautiful side of that is, I've had a dear brother and a dear friend now that I've met sit in a restaurant with tears streaming down his eyes. And he says, I can't believe it. that I didn't speak to one of my brothers, or two of them, for 25 years because somebody told me to mark them and shot them. And he talked about how the conviction of the Lord came on him just a couple of years ago. And he made quite a trip and went and was reconciled with his brothers and asked him to forgive him for ever taking on that spirit of being so holy that he could mark and shun his own brother over something. If I remember the story right, they had a thing about if you went to a certain type of church, you were marked and shunned. If you just visited. And here he didn't speak to him for 25 years over that because certain people told him that's what was an important scripture in the Bible. And many of us, or maybe many of you, will never run into that extreme. But I tell that story to make you realize that isn't what we're supposed to be finding in the scriptures about our Lord. We aren't supposed to be finding reasons to turn somebody out or find a reason to not show the Christ-like spirit to them. So as we read these stories and as we read these parables and these teachings, you know, a lot of people I've heard in the last few years, and it's a very good thought, they said, I'm not so concerned about all the doctrines now. I really want to just get down Matthew 5, 6, and 7, which is Sermon on the Mount. And I've had the same, you know, awakening that that's probably some of the most important things Jesus said. But I thought of even that. I want to go back and read each little piece and try to have the Holy Spirit reveal to me the real nature and character of Christ in that little phrase or that little, and make it personal to me. Make it where I would understand that. And because Jesus, right at the beginning, when he had went into the wilderness and he came back out, and he went into the temple and he asked for one of the scrolls to read, and he read from Isaiah, and he talks about the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. And the things he begins to list there are not to teach you all the creeds or whatever, but he talks about getting prisoners, releasing them from prison. He talks about delivering people that are bound. All these things, it starts telling you something about what our Lord was like. And so tonight, and as there was one phrase in one of those songs that said there's 1,000 stories about our Lord. Find the story that really touches your heart. Find out who Jesus really is. Find out and read them, all these stories again, and let them be made personal to you, that you begin to walk away. And this isn't just a trendy thing we're involved in, or we're just doing, you know, just doing activities. But if you can really understand what our Lord was like, then and begin to portray that, whatever this effort, this local effort is to be, or anywhere else, it will be successful because people will be drawn to that way before they're going to be drawn to how much scripture you can quote or how many doctrines you have to convince them of. And I'm thankful for that, that an old guy like me, it's not true. It's true probably about most things, but our Lord can teach an old dog new tricks. And I'm thankful that my heart has been open up to try to learn still more about our Lord.
That's awesome.
I'm not a very good speaker, Joel is. We go way, way back. And the thing that I've learned in all my life about the Lord is it's all about love. You know, he says in, Matthew 5, he says, you being evil want to give good gifts unto your children? How much more does your Heavenly Father want to give to you? And in my life, and I grew up right next to Joel, learned all those doctrines. Of course, I was older than you when I finally got my eyes open, but the Lord's continually opening my eyes about things. And to me, everything means, do I love my brother? No matter what his faults are, don't see his faults, but show him the love that the Lord showed me when I was really bad. and the Lord turned me around. And I just want to thank the Lord that He's shown me that love, and He's showing all of us. You're all young people. And years ago, some young people started a church. They had a vision. You know, see what you can do in this world for your Heavenly Father. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
I'm glad to be here today. The Lord is good. God is great. He's greatly to be praised. He inhabits our praises. Because God is worthy to be praised. Because like Joel was saying, you know, it's not just about what you know, but it's the love of God shed abroad in our hearts for what He's done for me through bringing me to a knowledge of repentance toward Him. He began to impart something into my soul through me coming and confessing my sins and begin to get a knowledge of what He can deliver you from and change your mind, not just put a doctrine in your mind, but His love wherein He loved us. God shed gave His Son to shed His blood for us. And that's what it's all about, is a response. With the first song that we was talking about, worship. Worship is a response to God's love towards us. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us so that we can be changed. That we don't have to be the same person that we used to be. But God can get a hold of us and change us so that we can be light and salt in the earth to show people that there is a Savior that can redeem you from anything. He can redeem you from the lowest of the low. If we have not sinned, whoever can say we have not sinned, but we have all come short. But God in His great mercy redeemed us. So that's our response to God today in worship, is a life giving Him our life to please Him for what He's done for us. It's only a natural response to the things of God that He's done for us, to live a life pleasing and holy and acceptable unto Him. And that's what I want to do, is with everything, all that was within me, bless His holy name by the way I live, the way I treat others, because it's only through His love that I can learn how to love others. And I want to be able to respond to that same love wherein He loved us, that I can show others how good my God is.
Yes.
I have just a short thought that I wanted to share with everyone. And it seems like it goes pretty well with the stuff that we've already heard. It's about love. So, how many of you, I'm just going to share this idea, and I want to ask how many of you have either thought or said this to somebody at some point in your life. So, you have, let's say there's another person, and this is what you're thinking about that person. You're thinking, I really don't like that person. Everything that person does just annoys me, just gets under my skin. Like, I really, really don't like that person. And then you think, but I love them because I love everybody. Like, how many of you guys have done that? Because I do that often, where you're like, well, I have to love everybody, so I love that person. And you just kind of like throw it on top of all of the horrible things that you already just thought about. Yeah, so that's a theme that I'm sure a lot of us are guilty of. Well, why do we do that? Why do we think that part at the end? That, oh, well, we have to love everybody, so we love that person, even though there's not really any evidence of that. And of course it's because the Bible presents love as sort of the principal virtue. Like, you have faith and you have hope and you have all these other things, and then there's love. And love trumps all of the others, because if you have love for somebody, you're going to demonstrate all of those other virtues naturally. And I mean, you have verses like, if I do all of these great things, if I move mountains and all this stuff and I have not love, I'm nothing. So love is obviously the most important of the virtues. And we know in our hearts when we do that about people and about things, when we throw love on top of a bunch of hatred, that it doesn't work. There's no actual real love there. We're just saying that so that we don't feel bad. But then let's think of another idea. What if instead of all of that, you said or thought, I really love that person, but this thing and this thing annoys me, but I really love that person. That's a whole different idea, even though you still are really irked by whatever it is that person does. It's a different idea that you start with love. Even if you still are annoyed by them, all of that is coming out of an already loving place. And I think that's a really powerful idea. That if we start with love, rather than just trying to throw love on top, rather than having love be an afterthought, that if we already have that love in our hearts, then no matter what this person idea thing does that annoys you, the love will already be there, so it won't engender hatred and malice in your heart. And I think that idea goes beyond this hypothetical scenario, that if we start with love, if love is already there when we enter, I don't know, some sort of conversation, when we enter into music and things like that, if the love is already there, then everything else will fall into place. And I think that's what Jesus was trying to convey when he said, oh, if you love your brother, you won't kill them. You won't steal from them. But the thing is that if there's already hate there and you try and put love into that hate, it's not going to work. The love has to be the forethought and not the afterthought. So that's just what I've been thinking about.